Hey, good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. How are we doing? Everybody excited about going to school tomorrow? I cannot believe they're already calling snow days for the next 2 days. Unbelievable. And it hasn't even started snowing yet. Wouldn't that be something? Yes, sir.
Jonah's homeschooled, so don't tell him about snow days.
Okay, there's
Jonah, earmuffs.
Yeah, I didn't say anything. Okay, guys, we're going to get started, and we're going to kind of turn a corner here a little bit. And tonight we're going to talk about the cardinal virtues, just about the overall, what a cardinal virtue is and what it means. We're not going to get into the individual cardinal virtues yet. That will come in weeks that come down the road. We're going to be doing some other things instead tonight, but for right now, let's begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your presence here this evening. We're so thankful for all those that were able to come here tonight. And Lord, we know we're anticipating a bit of a weather event, and I pray that as it unfolds, you keep us all safe, and especially for the upcoming funerals, Lord. Father, bless us tonight. Be with us as we prepare to take steps closer to you, to learn more about you, and to spend time alone with you. Father, we love you. It's in your great name we pray. We all said, amen. Okay, I don't know if you guys know this or not, but tug of war is a Summer Olympic sport. Yes. Now, in 1904, the United States won the gold medal, and it was 5-on-5 then, and then it went to, see, if you go to the International Olympic Committee's website, that's actually the logo for tug of war in the Olympics. Now, yeah, I kind of think that's cool, kind of stylish, you can tell what they're doing. In 1920, they went to 8 people per team. And it was a little bit different then, but this was the last year that they actually did tug of war in the Olympics. Although it is still a sport, they haven't done it since over 100 years. Now, there's actually a change.org page set up that somebody is trying to bring back tug of war in the Olympics. Look at these guys digging in, all right? Now, that's some serious tug of war. And this is what it says. This is the text on that page. It says, from 1900 to 1920, athletes from across the globe tested the limits of human strength and stamina in tug-of-war matches at the Olympic Games. Who didn't grow up with the sports legends of tug-of-war? The U.S. sweeping the medal count in 1904, 40 pullers descending on Antwerp in the final 1920 match. Yet today, school kids skip the muddy fields and chafing ropes in search of shallow glory and lesser sport. Which I found kind of funny. It's time for the International Olympic Committee to do what's right. Reinstate tug-of-war as an Olympic sport and restore the dignity and honor of this noble pursuit. This petition got 14 supporters. It died in a hurry, okay? So we're not going to have it as a sport again. However, here at OLGC, tug-of-war is alive and well. All right? It is alive and well. It is competitive. Nobody knows what's going to happen, and let's just kind of see how it plays out.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event. Let's get ready to rumble!
Y'all ready for this?
Yeah.
That looked like way too much fun.
No.
Way too much. We will never do tug of war again, okay? At least not with that role. We may reconsider a different role. And we actually have, I think, bonus footage on this. I didn't realize it, but the camera was set up pointed directly at our MC, and I was able to get his reaction, and it was kind of good.
The count of three!
I don't want this to move.
One! Two! How's everybody doing tonight?
Just go!
Two and a half!
Wow!
Three!
Yeah, the adults' faces were about the best part of the whole thing. Some of them were mortified, so yeah, some of them were just, I think everybody was just, and I contacted the gentleman that gave me that rope, Mr. Schneider. I don't know how many people know Mr. Schneider over at the school, yeah. And I sent him that video, and he died laughing, and I'm like, are you kidding me? What kind of rope did you give us? He says, oh, we haven't used that thing in years. It's just been sitting and dry rotting, and I said, well, it's in three pieces now, and it's in your storage room in the gym here if you ever want to use it again. So, what an event that was. Okay, this is what we're going to do. Real quick, review time for 2 minutes. What's a virtue? It's a what? I think it's a habit of doing good. You guys got that down. Okay, and then the three theological virtues we've covered: faith, the virtue by which we believe in God, and in all that he has revealed to us, hope, the virtue by which we trust God will fulfill his promises and look forward to eternal life, charity or love, the virtue by which we love God above all things and our neighbor as ourselves. That was the virtue we did last week. So, we have completed the theological virtues, and now we're going to turn the corner and we're going to get into the cardinal virtues, which are much more of the human virtues. And those four are prudence, temperance, fortitude, and justice. And we will spend a little bit of time on each of those going forward in the weeks to come. Prudence is the virtue that disposes practical reason to discern our true good in every circumstance and to choose the right means of achieving it. It guides the other virtues by setting rule and measure. And then there is temperance, and that's about self-control, all right? This is something that none of us can have too much of, all right? I can control myself, my thoughts, my words, my actions, my good choices, okay? And then there is the virtue of fortitude, which means having the courage to do the right thing, even though you are afraid. Even though you're afraid. The key word, I think, in that is courage. When I think of fortitude, the virtue, I think of courage. And then finally, justice. Justice is the moral virtue that consists in the constant and firm will to give their due to God and neighbor. Justice toward God is called virtue of religion. Now, when we break in a minute, I mean, the five groups that are confirmation prep, you guys doing the fruits of the Spirit, and what we're going to do tonight, just look at a couple of them. You guys are looking at kindness and goodness, and Mrs. Grobel is so good at this. When she puts these things together, she sent a couple quick videos to me that really demonstrate kindness and goodness. And they're very short videos. I'm going to show these to you really quick before we do kind of the next step this evening. And one, and both of these are people that, whether they pray the What's Mine to Do Here prayer or not, they saw a circumstance and they did something about it. They were prompted by the Holy Spirit to do something about it. This first one is kind of self-explanatory.
It's a simple act of kindness getting worldwide praise. A passenger on the New York City subway literally gives a frail and shivering homeless man the shirt off his back. The homeless man is so weak he can barely lift his arms, so the Good Samaritan gently pulls the shirt over his head for him, then adjusts it to make sure it's fitting okay. That's not all. Still feeling he hasn't done enough, the passenger goes back to his seat and fetches his hat, returning to carefully place it on the homeless man's head. Now meet the man with a heart of pure gold. He's 23-year-old Joey Resto, The video of his breathtaking act of kindness is gaining new viewers every hour. At last count, over an astonishing 42 million.
He lifted his arms up like a child and he let me put the clothes on him.
Joey's girlfriend, Yanni Martinez, says she couldn't be prouder.
He just decided to give the clothing that he had off his back. He didn't have much and he gave it to this guy who needed it more than anybody. So I thought that was pretty amazing.
If you see something wrong and you see something that you can do to help, do what you can. Don't just look and stare and wonder what if.
Words we can all live by.
I like kind of how he summed that up. When you see something that needs to be done, do what you can. You can't always do everything. You can't always give the shirt off your back. That may not always be the set of circumstances like he had there, you know, and he just saw that and he's like, how can I sit and look at this man, no shirt on? There was clearly, he probably has some type of a mental situation going on, and to be able to help somebody like that is, you're helping Jesus when that happens, okay? This next one is, watch it very close. It's only 1 minute long. It's actually a commercial, but it's a very cool commercial that kind of has a twist to it. So watch it very closely. Go ahead. Say it very loud. Why do you think they did that? Did that surprise you at the end?
Yeah.
Same here. It really surprised me. I thought that was such a neat commercial and such a neat way to look at it, what they do for people. Yes. What's it for?
Yeah.
Some beverage.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I forget. Sort of forget. But I think, you know how they always, Gatorade, who knows what it could be. There's all kinds of different. So, a couple of examples of goodness and kindness in action. I love those. Okay, guys, I'm sorry we didn't have more small group time. It was a little different this week. It's good to change things up once in a while. I'm so glad we got some adoration in, and these questions mean the world to us. They will all be looked at, and we will do everything we can to answer every single one. And just a real quick note for you guys, how careful you have to be when you have a phone around. I didn't realize that somehow my phone turned on and was recording me talking on auto text, and it sent it to my daughter. And this is what it says. She just got this text from me, and it says, "And so when you have a race, there is a Ham, okay? Fulfill his promises of the human virtues, the time to come by setting rule and measurement, temperance, control myself, my thoughts, my words, my." And then there is the virtue of fortitude, which means having the courage to do the right thing. It just goes on and on. It's like, oh my gosh, I read about a quarter of it and I sent it to her. I didn't mean to. I don't even know how it happened. All of a sudden she gets back to me and she's like, ha 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 ha, what's this? Like, oh, sorry. Never mind, disregard. Anyway, as we close, I want to introduce you to somebody named Amanda Riggin. And this young lady, let me tell you guys something. It's awesome being around people that are Christians their whole lives. They were born into a Christian family. They were raised Christian. They've always been Christian, and they're going to die a Christian and go right to heaven. You know, it's great. But I love being around people that's not the case. People that may have had unbelievable struggles the first half of their life, first 30 years or whatever, and then they found Jesus. and how their life changes. They have a different flavor about them. They have a different love for Jesus. And that's the case with Amanda Riggin. She did not know Jesus until just a couple of years ago. And she's a driver for FedEx. And something happened to her one day on her route, and the Holy Spirit got a hold of her. And she responded. She responded in a way, and she put a different kind of a spin on how you respond when the Holy Spirit tugs you. And at the end of her day, this is the day that it actually happened. At the end of her day, she sat in her truck and looked into her phone. She wanted to record how she felt so she could share it with her family and her friends. Ultimately, it ended up around the world. Millions and millions of people saw this.
Hey everyone, as you can tell, I'm at work. I just had to pull over and share something real quick. As I'm delivering, I pull up to this house. The lady walks out because she's checking her mailbox for her newspaper. And I have two boxes for her, so we start walking up the driveway together. And she asked me if I had a happy holidays, and I was telling her how busy it was. I told her I had a really great Christmas and New Year's, and I asked her the same. I was like, how was your holidays? And with tears in her eyes, she said, it wasn't good. And she said, he's sick. My husband's sick. He has cancer. I continued a small talk to try to change the subject because that's awkward. And I deliver her package. She said, what's your name? I said, Amanda. And she told me her name. I drove off. My heart's pounding. I do probably 20 more stops and I have to go back. You know, with this kind of job, we're on a tight schedule. Quicker you do it, the better. Quicker you get home. I stopped what I was doing. I went back to that neighborhood and rang her doorbell and asked her. She came down the stairs and she had tears in her eyes when she saw it was me. She smiled and I said, ma'am, can I pray with you? And she just broke down. She came out on the front porch and squeezed me so tight. This lady I've never met. She held my hand so tight, and I prayed for her and her family and for her husband. And the point of this is a lot of people want the Lord to use them. And for me as an example, I pray every day for the Lord to use me. But when he's trying to use you, or when you feel that call and that tug on your heartstrings, do you move your feet? Do you move? Because I easily could have just went. I have 100 stops. I easily could have just went about the rest of my day thinking about it. So when you feel those tugs on your heartstrings, and you feel like you need to do this, stop and do it. You know what I mean? Oh man. That was like the most genuine hug I have received in a long time. And I just want to share that with you guys. If you're praying for the Lord to help and to use you in people's situations, when he is giving you a chance, do it. If not, you're gonna continue to think about it and regret it. Like, so be sure you know what you're praying for when you're praying. I don't know, I just, it made me sad, but yet it made my day. This lady was just so alone. But anyway, you guys have a good day.
There's so much about that story that I love. I love what she did, obviously. It was awesome to go back and pray with that person. But the thing I love the most about the story is how she kind of broke it down at the end and said, if, you know, every day she gets up and prays, what are you going to do with me today, God? And then what am I going to do when you give me an assignment? When God gives you an assignment and you say no to it, it's not like he goes to the next person and gives it to somebody else, all right? There was nobody else in line to give that lady a hug. Nobody else in line to pray for that lady, except for Amanda. And she was prompted 20 stops later. She couldn't get that lady off her mind. And then she said what she does. She moved her feet. You know, we talk about what is it that God's asking? You know, what's mine to do here? For her, she says, move my feet. I have done a little bit of research on her to see if anything additional has become of this. And she actually has, she just has a heart for people. She has a heart for people. And she started this ministry. It's called Hungry Heroes. And something happened in her hometown where there were 4 police officers ambushed. And one of them died. And it broke her heart, because she comes from this little town. And she loves to cook. She barbecues. She has these big barbecue pits, and she takes them places and just does these huge, you know, grills food for people. And she started this ministry just in her hometown, and now the ministry's all over the country. All right. When God trusts you with something small and you respond and do it, He's going to keep giving you more, giving you more. I think there's like, she actually spoke just a couple of months ago at this national convention for police officers, and this is not a Christian convention, and there she is in all her tattoo glory, and just an amazing young lady. And this was her introduction. I don't know if this is going to come out, but this was her introduction. Because she spoke, but just listen to her introduction.
3 years ago in York County, South Carolina, our community suffered a great loss. Officers were ambushed, resulting in the death of Detective Mike Doty. I saw a community grieving and broken like never before. I saw brotherhoods of first responders come to the service from all over the nation. I wanted to give back. I started praying, Lord, please use me. Please let me be your hands and feet to say thank you for the sacrifices these men and women go through every day. The Lord spoke to my heart and said, feed them. So that's what I did, fed them a hot meal. I started out with one grill, one Boston butt. I made barbecue for the City of Rock Hill Police Department. That one gesture started our nonprofit called Hungry Heroes. We are now nationwide, traveling all over the nation, feeding first responders, police, fire, EMS, dispatchers, military, veterans. The COVID pandemic, we started feeding healthcare workers as well, from the custodial staff all the way up to the surgeons. This mission has really blessed me. I never intended it to leave York County, South Carolina, but it has blessed me. The Bible says when you are blessed, your family is blessed, and I've seen that come full circle. I enjoy nothing more than serving with my parents, serving with my family and friends, giving back to those that are deserving. My brother is a Marine, and he's a police officer. This has always been near and dear to my heart. We strive on prayers and donations, encouragement, and I just thank everyone who supports us. If you would like to help us continue to do this, to continue to grow, you can visit our website at hungryheroesbbq.com.
Now again, this was at a national convention that was not Christian. Did she share her faith just then?
Yeah.
Do you think anybody was bothered by that? I don't think so either. That's how you live like Jesus. That is so non-offensive and so attractive. And that's what people are drawn to. When we look for something to do for others and then we do it, and we do it with the right heart for the right reasons, and then we respond, you know, just as Jesus would. This is her, this is her Facebook page. This is what it says, her description of herself. Founder of Hungry Heroes, Inc. Listen to this. Servant at heart, striving to always be a vessel for the kingdom. Do you move your feet? All right? That's her challenge. This young lady, and I'm telling you what, she probably, I don't know if she can quote scripture all day long or not. My bet is she is so focused on helping others, she's so focused on being Jesus that's her ministry. All right? Each one of us needs to see this type of thing and ask God, what's mine that I need to do in my life like this? Because when you give me something small and I do it obediently, He's going to give you something bigger. Now she has a national ministry and she's helping people in an amazing way. She's doing something she loves and she's doing it for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for another amazing evening of time with you and with each other. Thank you for the ability to experience adoration once again. Thanks for a chance to ask questions, to be able to learn more about our faith, and to be able to be completely open about the things that we don't know and the things we'd like to know. Father, thanks for stories like the ones we've heard tonight of people that just step up and do the right thing, and they do it in a way that is so attractive to a broken, fallen world that needs to see this. And Lord, I know that's why you have us here right now. I know that's one of the themes you have for this year with the people in this room, is how can we be Jesus to others? So Lord, as we go forward this evening, please protect us, please keep us safe the next couple of days in the snow, and help us to always love you like you love us. It's in your great name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. All right, God.